Hi friends, in this video I want to share something that I've been working on. It's a simple website called taofigma.com. Here what I started is gathering simple rules or best practices that you can follow to bring more clarity into your design system, specifically into your Figma component libraries. None of this stuff is new or groundbreaking or difficult to implement or follow. It's simple stuff, but it definitely adds some integrity to your system and, like I already said, brings clarity. In this video, I'm going to go through each of the points that I have here one by one, hopefully bringing a little bit more context for each. Anyway, let's start with the first one. And the first point is that for all components in your library, you want to make sure that they have a naming convention. And that naming convention is going to apply to everything. It's going to apply to your component names, to the property names, to property value names. It really doesn't matter what the naming convention is, as long as it's consistent for all the components. For example, you may choose to keep your components uppercase and have spaces between words. Sometimes I see this naming convention for components where you just don't have a space. The reason it's done is so that the component matches the actual component and code, like a React component one-to-one. I definitely see the value in that, but I do think it can impact readability, especially if you have a pretty long component name. So I don't think it's an issue to add spaces in your component names just because you can, while still making sure that the name itself matches the code component. But this is my personal view. I prefer to have spaces. If you don't, you don't. Just keep it consistent. Just like you have a naming convention for your component names, you would also do that for properties. You may want to choose to capitalize them. Again, just an example. And the same thing you would do with property values. While component names and property names, values are obvious aspects of a component library, other things that we should consider are hidden components and deprecated components. So there are multiple ways to create a hidden component in Figma. You can start your component name with a dot or an underscore. I prefer to pick one way and just do that. Then also you can choose to maybe keep all the words lowercase, separate them with dashes, something. When you look at the component right away, you can be like, okay, it's a hidden component. Then also for deprecated components, my completely honest opinion is just to remove a deprecated component right away. I understand that sometimes it can be useful to have a time period where you just deprecate the component by marking it as deprecated and then deleted maybe a couple weeks or a month later. But regardless of that, for deprecated components, you especially want to have a clear naming convention. You can write deprecated in all caps before component name. You can also add something to the description of that component. And you just want to make sure that it's consistent. If we look at this example on the right, one component has it one way, another one has deprecated in parentheses after the component name, which I don't recommend because then if you look at the list of the components and the component name is too long, then you may not see like that deprecated in parentheses. It's just better to have the important thing out in front of the component name. And then something that also I've seen happen is that there is a common notion that a component is deprecated and it might be maybe in some deprecated page inside the component library file, but the component name itself may not reflect the fact that it's deprecated. As an example, so let's say this page, we just call it deprecated and we bring these two components here, a button and a toast. The thing is that the designer experience is going to be, let's say they search for like toast and they see this component, it doesn't tell them that it's inside a page that's called deprecated. So they just see this and they might think like, oh, like I can use this component. Whereas actually they're not supposed to, which is why instead you want to do something like this and then you search for it and it comes out as deprecated. Okay, let's move on to the next point, which is putting properties in a logical order. And for this one, we'll go back to our toast example. Let's inspect this component. We assume that the reading direction is left to right. So in this case, we want to organize our properties from top to bottom. Right now, we have our first property is the variance, and the variance there always going to be at the top. Like Figma doesn't allow you to move any component properties above the variance. But then from here, since we have our icon first, then description, then link, then dismiss button, the way our properties panel is going to be organized, we'll have the Boolean for the icon first, then we'll have the actual icon selector, then we'll have a Boolean for link, link text, and then we'll have a Boolean for dismiss button. As a consumer, when I look at this component, if I have the icon toggled off, I can work with this component based on this mental mapping, as opposed to, let's say, I had an icon at the bottom, which is not very intuitive. And then when I toggle it on and off, the setting for actually picking your icon like pops up somewhere at the top. It can definitely create a frustrating experience working with a component where everything is out of order. Again, it's not difficult to create a logical order for your properties, but it's something that I see designers miss a lot. And the next one is favoring Boolean component properties over variants. The simplest way to think about this, if there is a certain layer in your component that could just be toggled on or off, meaning you can change its visibility from visible or not visible, then you should use a Boolean component property as opposed to creating a variant for it. Let's go back to our toast component. Here I now have two examples. This first one is made with Boolean properties, and this one has a variant for everything. And there are obviously a couple issues going on here. The first one is that you just have way more variants to manage. And if you want to add one little teeny tiny thing to your component or maybe add a different color variant, you have to do a lot of work. And another thing that we've already briefly talked about is that in the properties panel, all variant settings are always at the top, which means that if you create a variant for showing an icon, then you can't have an actual configuration for swapping an icon instance right under this show icon variant setting. As a consumer, you end up with something like this, where your icon setting comes out somewhere at the bottom. And it's definitely not as bad of an experience as when it comes up like right above the Boolean property setting, but still it's not ideal. I understand that Boolean component properties may not be as intuitive and quick to implement as variants when you're just starting out with them. But all it is just practice. Just practice building like 5 different components using Booleans, and it will become a second nature to you, and you will be building much efficient components from that point on. All right, this next one is naming your layers. If you're building component library that other designers will be using, that you'll be using, it makes sense to invest a little bit of time into naming your layers. Not all of your layers have to have semantic meaning. It could be as simple as container or frame, but all in all, layers for components should be cleaned up. I think it's as simple as respect to your teammates. It's respect to your future self. Allowing yourself to take the time to look through your layers to make sure that you don't have any extra layers or groupings that are unnecessary. To make sure that everything is clear, not just visually on Canvas, but also from the layers panel. It will help you refine your components, make them as best as they can be. Anyway, moving on to the next point, it's don't nest components in unnecessary frames. Sometimes I see designers creating a frame, not naming it, by the way, and then placing a component in there. Actually, let's delete that. Placing a component in there, they do it because they want their designs, their file to look like neat and organized and static. That's great, but as a designer, if I search for a component or browse through the library, I end up with a situation like this, where I just have some random frame name and then a component hidden inside it. There's definitely a use case for grouping some components within their own categories, but it has to be done intentionally. It's also best to use an actual section for it. The reason why I think not all designers use that yet is because section is still a relatively new feature, so not everyone just knows about it. But the point is definitely use sections to group your components. Just make sure that it's done with intention and that it creates a good designer experience when they go in and browse through the components in the assets. Next point, recursive components. This one is just bad, bad, bad. Please don't ever do this. And the best way to explain this would be by making a demo. So let's say we are making an accordion component, accordion item, for example. Let me just give it a fill. Let's rename it to accordion item. we'll turn this into a component, and then we'll add like a variant. For our property, we will do state. This one will be default. This one will be power. We'll change this fill to like a more gray. And let's also give it like a bottom stroke. Oh, and the last thing, maybe I'll grab like an icon. All right. Not the prettiest, but now what I want to do is create an expanded version for my accordion item. So if I wanted to create an expanded version of this, I would need to do a lot of tinkering with these layers, maybe put this into their own auto layout and to shape this whole variant just to be able to add that content text section. And so what I've seen happen is that some designers take an instance of the accordion item component, and then let's do like text. They would create accordion content container and they would combine it with accordion item inside out layout. They would rename this as accordion item, turn it into a component, and they would place it back inside into the original accordion item. What we have here now is that we have a variant of an accordion item that nests in itself a variant of an accordion item, this first one here. And this just creates such a confusing experience for somebody using the component or for somebody who wants to maintain the component. And Figma does throw this message that components can contain instances of themselves, which is helpful, but unfortunately it does not prevent somebody actually creating a component with a recursive instance. So if you run into a situation like this, like with the accordions, you can still use an existing instance to create another variant, but just make sure that you detach this instance. Maybe like this would be just an accordion button, and only then you place it back into your component set. This way you don't end up with this recursion. All right, we're halfway there. The next one is setting most commonly used variant as the default one. So for example, let's take a look at our button example here. Right now, if I were a designer, I would go and search for this button. I would drag it onto the screen. And by default, the variant is a small primary button. And I think if you look at most applications, most of the time you will have a medium secondary button as most commonly occurring button. Since that secondary button would be the most common one, it makes sense for us to make it a default variant. This way the designers have less tinkering to do every time they use that component. But the sad thing for us design system designers is that we also want our component sets to be organized neatly, like you have here on the screen. So what we can do to change this is bring this variant in the top left corner. Also, just to note, I am using auto layout to organize my component set. This is nice because it allows you to move your component variants quickly. And then if you add a new variant, you don't need to reorganize your existing variants to make space for it. Anyway, we can bring this variant in top left corner, but of course now our component set doesn't look as neat and definitely not ideal. Something you can do is just bring all of your relevant variants up on the top and maybe just organize them like medium, small, large, so that the component set itself still looks organized. The next one is making icon components obvious and clear. This is as simple as adding icon at the end of the name. We can look at this screenshot that I have here. In this first screenshot, when you go and you search for assets, you search for something like a menu. And so a menu could be an actual component, or it can also be an icon like the three dots or like the burger menu. Here on the left, you can tell right away which one is the menu, which one is the menu icon. But here on the right, yes, you can look at the thumbnails, but it's not obvious right away. And while thumbnails are big enough in this assets view, when you go to something like an instance swap, they're really small. So this is where it's especially helpful to have icon at the end of the icon names so that it's clear what you're picking. The next one is creating unnecessary components, especially for things like component subparts. As an example, we can go back to our toast component. What I see some designers do is that they would take a part like this and they would turn it into their own separate component. It would be a hidden component. and then they'll just place it inside their actual component. And I think sometimes subcomponents are useful and save lots of time, but most of the time, I feel like they create more noise and they're unnecessary. If you want to change a part of a component and you want to have that part changed for all the variants, what you can do is you can use this little selection tool to select all of the matching layers. And then if you need to update spacing or if you want to update color or something like that, you can just do it directly from here. It's such a small, but it's a very convenient way to manage your components without having to resort to creating subcomponents. In a similar vein, something that I also see happens a lot is that components tend to have too many unnecessary nestings and frames. For example, if we take a look at this variant, so it has its own frame for description, then it has the link, then it has an icon button. But when I look at some components, I see, for example, this description part could be wrapped in its own frame, which is absolutely unnecessary in this case because your auto layout frame is already a frame. And then you also might have an extra wrapper for your text. Generally, I think the less framing, the less nestings, the better. Because the thing is, the more layers and nestings you have, the more debugging you have to do when something goes wrong. It becomes much more difficult to diagnose the problem, like at which layer the issue is happening. Also, too many unnecessary layers just creates more clutter. Okay, last one is don't create unnecessary documentation. Especially don't duplicate documentation in multiple places because you're just doubling the amount of work for yourself. And if you can go without documentation, great, don't have it. And what I mean by that is that sometimes in component libraries inside Figma, I see designers either using plugins to create a full-on wiki of that component or just like adding labels like this variant is success, info, error. I honestly think being this thorough with documentation could actually lead to more problems than benefits because first, you are just creating more management work for yourself and there's already lots that's probably on your mind. Second, this is just my personal pet peeve is again, we're cluttering the layers panel by adding more unnecessary stuff. The third thing is that designers who are not design system maintainers are probably not going to have the component library file open at all times, and they're not going to reference and see all the wonderful things that you put in here. They'll be interacting with the component from the assets panel in their own file. So all that they will see is something like this. And fortunately, Figma recently introduced useful playground features that both designers and developers can use to learn more about the component. I think that's the right philosophy, is that the best way to learn about how something works is not to read about it, but to actually spend time playing with it. It's also more fun, I think. And of course, depending on the size of the team, on the kind of situation that you have, it might make sense to have a very thorough documentation. If you have people outside your company that are using your design system, for example, Atlassian has a marketplace. So for them, it makes sense to have a very detailed documentation. So someone who doesn't work at the company can understand and can learn it and start working with it. But when you actually work at the company, you have the opportunity to go straight to the source and to play around with the components. The very last thing that I wanted to say is that I do think there is benefit to very simple documentation, but that I think should live not inside Figma, but on a website with a simple URL that anyone at your company can access and that serves as a single starting point for both designers and developers. All right, that's everything that I wanted to cover today. I'd appreciate any feedback as well as if you have any other like tips or things that you do to keep your component libraries simple, lean, consistent. I'd love to learn about them. Also, I'd love to hear any suggestions for improving this website if you think there is something that could be useful to you. Also, if you spot any typos, I would really, really appreciate to know about those. Anyway, thank you for watching and until next time. Bye-bye.